Here's your possibility. Or your option, I should say. Next week, turn in a revised version of the essay that you submitted for grade, okay, the one that you got back. But you have to submit it with the original one. That is, I need to be able to compare the revised version against the unrevised version, the graded marked up version, right? I will be really hard on these. And what I mean by that is, you don't make the corrections, you zip, okay? I mean, I expect anything that I circled, anything that was wrong needs to be fixed, okay? If I had a bunch of questions at the end, or if I had a bunch of questions in it that talked about, you know, it's vague, ambiguous, huh? I don't have a clue what you're saying. Try to make it so I will have a clue what you're saying, okay? For the revision, you can go up to 1,250 words. So that if you need additional space to clarify, you've got additional space to clarify, okay? You can't go below 750. Because none of those questions can be answered in less than 750 words. I can guarantee you that. Well, I'll take that back. They could, but they'd be bad. Okay? None of them can be adequately answered in less than 750 words. Okay? So, that's your opportunity to get up to 15 points extra credit. Okay? And again, points will probably range. If you do a minimal job, that is, if you correct some but not all of them, you might get a point or two. Hell, a point or two can add up. It can make a difference. Okay? You know, 5 points raises that F to a D minus. Okay? And you do well on the other things, and that raises that D minus on you. Is it going to enable you to go from an F on your first paper to an A in the course? Not likely, unless your remaining papers are all A's. Okay? Really, really good A's. Okay? All right. Did either Shalia come in or Janelle? I think they've left us forever, as Professor Trelawney would say. Last week, I think I skipped something pretty important. My memory told me Tuesday morning, or maybe it was Thursday morning, I can't remember which, that when I went over Goblet of Fire in class, in this class, that I skipped a pretty important chapter, which I've now... marked. Did I go over well, let me put it this way. Where did I leave off? I left off at the Goblet of Fire? Oh, okay. Then I was completely addled myself. Because I thought I had left off much later than that. That's why I have another marker in here that the book didn't open to. Okay, that makes me feel a lot better. Okay, picking up where we left off then with Goblet of Fire, which is chapter 16. I'm going to skip a bunch just at the beginning. Page 2... 255 and following. Dumbledore is talking to the students, and he's telling them about the goblet of fire, and he says at the bottom of 255, anybody wishing to submit themselves as champion must write their name and school clearly upon a slip of parchment and put it in the goblet. But, he says, he has mentioned only students 17 years and older will be allowed to participate. Which meant Craig, George, Reed, Laverne, and I, because they turned 17 the following spring. And Dumbledore says, to ensure that no under, 256, to ensure that no underage student yields to temptation, I will be drawing an age line around the Goblet of Fire. Once it's been placed in the entrance hall, nobody under the age of 17 will be able to cross the line. That doesn't mean that they won't be able to yield to temptation. I mean, they're going to try. Temptation is still going to call, as we will see very shortly with Fred and George. Okay? He just means you won't be able to succeed in giving in to that temptation. Okay? And then he gives this little paragraph about how serious this competition is. It's not the competition itself that's serious, however. It's the names that come out of the goblet. Because of what the goblet kind of implies. It says, once a champion has been selected by the Goblet of Fire, he or she is obliged to see the tournament through to the end. Placing of your name in the goblet constitutes a binding magical contract. He never says what the conditions are if one breaks the contract. Later on in the series, we're going to be introduced to another binding magical contract. Okay? And if you break that contract, you die. That's not said here. In fact, what are we told about the conditions of the Triwizard Tournament this time as opposed to when it's been engaged in the past? Anybody remember? No one will die. In previous Triwizard tournaments, contestants have died. They're making it so that this time, that won't happen. Okay? There can be no change of heart once you have become a champion. Please be very sure, therefore, that you are wholeheartedly prepared to play before you drop your name into the goblet. Okay? So there's a bit more talk back and forth. And Hermione goes off on her spew rant. So we're going to skip a bunch. Pick up with 269. It's now time for the goblet to spit out its names. And it churns out the first one. And we're told 269, the champion for Durmstrang will be Victor Krum. Okay, and I talked about the names of the schools last week. Durmstrang comes from the German phrase Sturm und Drang, which means storm and stress. Beauxbatons just means beautiful wand or beautiful baton. Okay. The next one comes out. Okay. Champion for Beauxbatons, we're told, is Fleur Delacour, whose name means flower of the heart. Okay. And notice, we're told that the rest of her classmates at Beauxbatons are all kind of downcast. Like, not because they weren't chosen. It's because she was chosen. Like, the impression is Fleur is not top of the class. Okay? Nobody says anything about Victor Krum, because, I mean, it's kind of implied he beat the snot out of you or something. Okay? Hogwarts champion, Cedric Diggory, which has got to be really hard for Harry after what Amos Diggory had to say when he met Harry at the Portkey. Ron, no! You know, because describe Cedric Diggory. Two words will do it. Pretty boy. I mean, he's the male underwear model, as it were. Okay? Everybody, except for Hufflepuffs, hates him. Dumbledore starts blabbing on along about now we have our champions, and then the goblet starts acting up again. Pew, Harry's name comes out. So Harry goes on through the little door where he meets Fleur, Victor, see Cedric, and the other school heads, headmistress Madame Maxime and headmaster Igor Karkaroff, are about to pop a gasket. They're so angry because this does what? Hogwarts now has what? In other words, it goes from a 33% chance of winning to a 50% chance of winning. Okay? So we have in this room, we've got Dumbledore, we've got Madame Maxime, we've got Igor Karkaroff, we've got the four champions, and who else is in there? Who? Ludo Bagman, Barty Crouch, and Snape. Louder?
Mad-Eye.
And Mad-Eye Moody. Okay? Snape immediately thinks what? Come on, it's not hard. This is Snape, and we're talking about Harry. He cheated. He did something. I mean, look what happened at the end of the previous book. Potter did it. I mean, kind of went a little, you know, bat crazy there. So Karkaroff says, let us put other names in. And Bagman's like, it won't do that. It's going to stay dead, unlit, whatever, until the next try was determined. Okay? And Moody finally chimes in. After Karkaroff says, well, maybe we'll leave. Empty threat, Karkaroff. You can't leave your champion now. He's got to compete. I mean, Dumbledore made it very clear. We don't know what would happen if he tried to leave. You know, would his head fall off or whatever. Okay. So Moody says, it's pretty convenient, isn't it? This binding magical contract. Karkaroff's like, what do you mean convenient? I don't understand you, Moody. Moody, don't you? It's very simple, Karkaroff. Someone put Potter's name in that goblet knowing he'd have to compete if it came out. Madame Maxime, evidently someone who wished to give Hogwarts two bites at the apple. Karkaroff, I agree. Moody, if anyone's got reason to complain, it's Potter. But what? He's not saying a word. Okay? I don't hear him saying a word. Fleur, why should he complain? He has the chance to compete, hasn't he? We've all been hoping to be chosen for weeks and weeks. It's an honor for our school. It's 1,000 gallons of prize money. This is a chance many would die for. There's that, you know, many would die for. Maybe someone's hoping Potter is going to die for it, says Moody. Okay? And then Karkaroff kind of laughs Moody off. Because what do we know about Mad-Eye Moody? What have we heard about him? What are the rumors? Ron heard a little bit of this before he left home.
He's very paranoid.
Yeah, he's paranoid. Okay, why is he paranoid?
Because he was an auror for so long,
and he used to arrest bad guys, or kill them, possibly, or send them to Azkaban without trials, or send them to Azkaban with trials. Okay. Moody, you think I'm imagining things, huh? It was a skilled witch or wizard who put the boy's name in that goblet. Madame Maxime, what evidence is there of that? And he's like, come on. They hoodwinked a very powerful magical object. It would have needed an exceptionally strong Confundus charm to bamboozle that goblet into forgetting that only three schools compete in the tournament. Why is Moody saying this? Or, let's give away the end, why is Barty Crouch Jr. saying this?
Takes the suspicion away from him.
Okay, takes the suspicion away from him. Why else?
He wants Harry to compete.
He wants Harry to compete. Why else? Go back to the takes suspicion away from him. What's he doing? Isn't he acting exactly as Mad-Eye Moody would act? Keep in mind, what's Moody's job at Hogwarts?
Chasing.
Not chasing bad guys. It's defense against the dark arts. What's he doing? He's thinking like a investigator would, investigating some kind of dark magical activity. He's going at it like an FBI agent would. He's trying to figure out what are motives, okay? Not just what kind of opportunities did people have to do it. Karkaroff, who kind of picks up on this? You seem to have given this a great deal of thought, Moody. Very ingenious theory it is. Okay? Moody, there are those who will turn innocent occasions to their advantage. It's my job to think the way dark wizards do. Karkaroff, notice the little pause, as you ought to remember. And Dumbledore's like, down to it! Alistair, okay? Because he just kind of let slip something there. Did he accuse Karkaroff of being a dark wizard? Accuse. No, he didn't accuse. Did he charge him with being a dark wizard? No, he didn't do that. What did he do? He insinuated. Okay? He insinuated. So, Dumbledore ultimately has the last word. Why? Because Dumbledore applies logic to the situation. We don't know how Harry's name got in there. But what do the laws of the Triwizard Tournament dictate? Your name comes out, you have to play. Okay? So, Harry goes back up to the Gryffindor Common Room. And what does he find? As he makes his way up, page 283, he's wondering, was anyone except Ron and Hermione going to believe him? Or would they all think he put himself in the tournament? That, or would they all think, means all the other Gryffindors. Possibly all the other Hogwarts students. But notice what he thinks. Who's going to be with him? Hermione and Ron will stick with him. But someone else had considered it. Someone else had wanted him in the tournament. Why? To get him killed? Was Moody just being his usual paranoid self? Did someone really want him dead? And he starts thinking, yeah, Voldemort. Harry goes in, and he's being treated as a conquering hero. Okay. Fred, you should have told us you'd entered. Well, that kind of immediately does away with that thought. Will they all think? I mean, if Fred thinks Harry entered on his own, everybody else goes off to bed, finally. And Harry's left down there with Ron. Page 286. Because Ron's come in. Actually, they're up in their dormitory. Ron says, congratulations. What do you mean, congratulations? Well, no one else got across the H lane. What'd you do, use the invisibility cloak? Invisibility cloak wouldn't have got me across the line. Oh, right. Thought, you know, you said you drew it. You told me if it was cloak, because, I mean, it's covered both of us. Harry, I didn't put my name in the goblet. Someone else must have done it. Ron raises his eyebrows. Why would they do that for? I don't know. To kill me? Ron's eyebrows rose so high that they were in danger of disappearing into his hair. What does that mean? Why do Ron's eyebrows go all crazy? Does he think Harry's putting this on? Harry's acting this? It's okay, you know. You can tell me the truth. What does that tell us? Ron thinks what? Harry's lying to him. Notice, you can tell, and Rowling has them italicized me. In other words, I won't tell anybody else. If you don't want everybody else to know, fine. But I don't know why you're bothering to lie. You didn't get into trouble for it, did you? In other words, if you got into trouble, yeah, then you'd have to fess up to the lie. Ron's got an interesting case of ethical, what do I want to call this here? Screwy ethics. It's okay to lie if you don't get caught. Harry, I didn't put my name in that goblet. Yeah, okay. Only you said this morning you'd have done it last night and no one would have seen you. I'm not stupid, you know. Doing a really good impression of it. Yeah? Okay. So we're going to skip a bunch. Harry writes a letter off to Sirius. He has care of magical creatures with Hagrid, and Hagrid says to him, page 295,
I don't know a school champion. Everything seems to happen to you, doesn't it?
Okay. Remember in Prisoner of Azkaban, Harry told Mr. Weasley he doesn't go looking for trouble. It just kind of finds him. Okay. That's kind of what Hagrid is suggesting here. Everything happens to Harry. Okay. We see Malfoy makes the buttons that support Cedric Diggory, the real Hogwarts champion. And he says, and this isn't all they do, bottom of 297, presses his badge, and then the button changes to say Potter stinks. Okay. Hermione gets involved. And Harry and Malfoy curse each other at the same time. Their curses hit in midair and deflect. Okay. Harry's hits Crab or Goyle, doesn't matter which one, they're both the same. And Malfoy's hits Hermione right in the face. And Malfoy's is dens algeo. Dens, like dentist. Algeo, which means to increase or grow. And her teeth start to grow like a beaver's. So that within a matter of minutes, her top teeth are hanging over her bottom lip. And they keep on growing. And then we see one of the meanest, rottenest, nasty, slimiest things Snape does in the entire series. When Hermione asks permission to go up to the hospital wing to get her teeth fixed, he says, why? I see no difference. Oh. I mean, that's the kind of thing a 16-year-old Snape probably would have said. Not to mention however old he is, 36 or so, 31 or so, that he is here. Okay? So Harry gets called up to the weighing of the wands, and he gets waylaid by Rita Skeeter, who essentially jumps him in a broom closet. I don't mean jumps him sexually, but she give her time, probably, from what we know of Rita Skeeter. She starts to talk, and her quill starts to write. Her quill starts to write, and it doesn't write what she says. Okay. Dumbledore rescues him. He gets a letter from Sirius asking him to meet Sirius in the fireplace, Gryffindor Tower, 22nd of November, page 312. Okay. Chapter 19, there's a lot to get through, so I'm going through it quickly. Chapter 19, page 322, we find out Moody's magical eye can see through invisibility cloaks, which may be a problem. May not be a problem. I haven't figured this one out yet. Because later in the series, writes that the invisibility cloak can withstand all spells. Now, his magical eye doesn't work via a spell. But what good's an invisibility cloak if you can get a magical eye that sees through it? We know absolutely nothing about Moody's magical blue eye. We have no idea where he got it. We no idea how it was made. We no idea what it is, other than that it can not only see forward through a magical cloak, it can also see through the back of his head. So it probably has a lot to do with your mother saying, "I can see you through the back of my head." A rolling play on that old notion. Okay. The Daily Prophet comes out. Let's see here. Where do I want to pick up? And Harry goes down to meet Hagrid because Hagrid's asked to meet him at, I think it was midnight or 11 o'clock. Hagrid's kind of going on a, not quite a date, but kind of a date with Madame Maxime. And he has Harry go down with his invisibility cloak. What's Hagrid showing Madame Maxime and Harry at the same time?
Dragons.
So Harry knows the first task has something to do with dragons. He's got to get past dragons. Okay? What else does he know? He sees Karkaroff. Okay? So Crumb's going to know. Fleur's going to know. Harry knows. And he goes back upstairs and he meets with Sirius. And he tells Sirius about the dragons. He says, "Don't worry about dragons, we can deal with those." He does tell Harry that Karkaroff was a Death Eater. He was in Azkaban when Sirius was there. But he did a deal with the Ministry and got out. Okay? How'd he get out? Because he apparently, why is somebody calling me? He apparently named names. Okay. You're in prison, you name names, you get out. What kind of standing does that put you in with those who were friends, lovers, acquaintances of those whom you named?
Not good.
Yeah, not so good. Okay. And then Sirius says 333. He talks a little bit about Rita Skeeter's article about the Quidditch World Cup. And then Harry says, "So, are you saying Karkaroff's trying to kill me?" Sirius, "I've been hearing some very strange things. Death Eaters seem to be a bit more active than usual. They showed themselves at the Quidditch World Cup. And then Bertha Jorkins went missing." Harry, "Who?" "Exactly. She disappeared in Albania. That's definitely where Voldemort was rumored to be last. And she would have known the Triwizard Tournament was coming up, wouldn't she?" Harry, "Yeah, but it's not like she would have walked straight into Voldemort." Harry, Sirius, "I knew Bertha Jorkins." Correct pronunciation would be Jorkins. "She was at Hogwarts when I was, a few years above your dad and me. She was an idiot. Very nosy, no brains at all. Not a good combination." Harry, so Voldemort could have found out about the tournament? Is that what you mean? You think Karkaroff might be hearing his orders? Notice how close he is to having it figured out." "I don't know, just don't know." "Harry, it looks like a good plan from where I'm standing. All they have to do is stand back and let the dragons do their stuff." Okay? So they start to talk about the dragons. Harry hears a noise, Sirius disappears, and Ron comes down. "Who are you talking to? What's that there got to do with you? Why are you down here? Just wondered where you were." "Nothing. I'm going back to bed. I just wondered where you were." "Why? Why would give Scabbers you know what? Why would Ron give Scabbers you know what for where Harry is. Why would he care? Is their relationship, is their friendship destroyed? No. No. Ron's wondering, why is it Harry in the dorm? Nothing. Because notice, I just wondered where you, and then there's a pause, and then Ron broke off, shrugging. The shrugging kind of means, I don't give a damn. Nothing. Just thought you'd come running around, nosing around, did you? Says Harry. Right? What's Harry doing there? Jumping to a huge, big, fat conclusion. Based upon what evidence or what logical premises? Zero. None. Right? Ron, sorry about that. Should have realized you didn't want to be disturbed. I'll let you get on with practicing for your next interview in peace. Harry takes one of the buttons and throws it at him. Hits him on the forehead. It says there, something for you to wear on Tuesday. You might even have a scar now if you're lucky. It's what you want, isn't it? What's Harry mean?
He
wants what?
He wants to be him.
Okay. What did Ron see when he looked in the mirror of Erisa?
Oh, he wanted all the glory that Harry had got entering the tribe as a tournament.
I mean, he saw himself as head boy, Quidditch captain, and they just won the Quidditch Cup. And who's he surrounded by? Nobody. It's just Ron. Ron getting all the glory. Harry remembers that. And that's why he says, it's what you want, isn't it? To have a scar, to be seen, to be noticed. Right? When this book first came out, there was a lot of stuff on the internet speculating what this meant. Because by the time this one had been written, Rowling had already said she knew what the very last word of the very last chapter of the very last book was. Because she said, at the time, she had already written the last chapter. She hadn't written 5 through 7, but she'd written the last chapter of number 7. And the very last word was scar. And some people were suggesting that it was going to refer to Ron because of this comment by Harry. Couldn't have been more wrong. Okay. So Harry's got the first task. The next day, he goes about his business. Monday morning comes, and Harry's thinking, Crumb knows, Fleur knows, I know, Cedric doesn't. And so he makes Cedric's book bag split, and then runs up to him, helps him, and he says, bottom of 340, Cedric, first task is dragons. What? Dragons. They've got 4, one for each of us. We've got to get past them. Are you sure? Dead sure. Probably not the best choice of words, but how did you find out? We're not supposed to know. Never mind. I'm not the only one who knows. Fleur and Crumb will know by now. Maxime and Karkaroff saw the dragons too. Why are you telling me? Now, for me, having Cedric say, why are you telling me, is always a problem. Because what does that tell us about Cedric? Reverse the situations. Would Cedric tell Harry based upon what he just said? No. Okay. Harry looks at him, notice, in disbelief. He can't believe Cedric would say anything like that. He was sure Cedric wouldn't have asked that if he'd seen the dragons himself. Harry wouldn't have let his worst enemy face those monsters unprepared. Well, maybe Malfoy or Snape. It's just fair, isn't it? We all know now. We're on an even footing, aren't we? What's this tell us about Harry's attitude toward sport? It ought to be even. I don't mean even. You know, you have the same quality caliber players on every team. Not that kind of even. But the opportunities to win, okay, ought to be even. You shouldn't have somebody, you know, soccer, my game, you shouldn't have a team with 9 competing against a team of 11. It's just not right, okay? If the team of 9 started with 11, got 2 red cards, that's their own fault. In which case, you know, you kill the ref. Cedric's still looking at him in a slightly suspicious way. Moody shows up. Come with me, Potter. Off you go, Diggory. Harry's thinking, no, I mean, not yet. And look what Moody says. That was a very decent thing you did, Potter. A very, what? Decent. Now, decent is one of those words that would apply if we had the 4 houses up. Not to Gryffindor. It would apply to Hufflepuff. So he takes Harry into his office. And Harry sees all these anti-dark magic stuff. And Moody starts pointing out and explaining what everything means. And then he finally says, 343, so found out about the dragons, have you? Harry nods. Moody, it's all right. Cheating's a traditional part of the Triwizard Tournament. Always has been. Notice Dumbledore didn't say that. He didn't tell everybody, if you can cheat and get in, have at it. Or, once your name comes out, if you can cheat to win, bully for you. None of that. Harry, I didn't cheat. Notice, Harry feels like his honor has been smirched. Sort of an accident, found out. I wasn't accusing you, laddie. I've been telling Dumbledore from the start, he can be as high-minded as he likes, but you can bet old Karkaroff and Maxime won't be. In other words, cheat, kid. Cheat up and down. Okay? So you got any ideas how you're going to get past your dragon? Harry, nope. So Moody says, let me give you a piece of advice. Play to your strengths. This is just like Gandalf telling Frodo, you must use such heart, strength, and wits as you have on your way to destroy the ring. And Frodo says, I haven't got any. Look at that. Harry, I haven't got any. I don't have any strengths. You've got strengths if I say you've got them. What are you best at? Harry tried to concentrate. Well, what was he best at? Well, it's easy. Quidditch. Being best at Quidditch, how far is that going to get him in Hogwarts? How's that going to help him next year on his owls? Or in his 7th year on his newts? Nastily exhausting wizarding tests. Moody, that's right. You're a damn good flyer from what I've heard. Harry, yeah, but I'm not allowed a broom. Almost like he's going to sit down and start whining. Second piece of advice, get what you need. Just so happens, Flitwick's been teaching them summoning charms, which Harry can't do. Hermione did it the first day. Okay. Harry looks at him blankly. What did he? He just talked about Quidditch. Come on, boy. Put them together. It's not that difficult. He's like, maybe he really does belong at, you know, St. Brutus's. Harry, Hermione, I need you to help me. So he and Hermione start practicing. Page 349. They go down for the actual task. And Ludo Bagman, all the champions are there. Ludo Bagman says, all right, now that we're all here, when the audience is assembled, I'm going to be offering each of you this bag. He holds up a small purple silk bag, shakes it at them, from which you will select a small model of the thing you're about to face. And I have to tell you something else, too. Your task is to collect the golden egg. Okay? I discovered something. I don't think it was my last trip to London. It was 2011. And I think Rowling knew this when she wrote this. In the early 90s, don't remember what year exactly, 92 or so, a new tourist, kind of touristy site opened in London called the Cabinet War Rooms. These were the rooms beneath Whitehall, which is a where the seats of government is essentially in London. Beneath Whitehall, where Winston Churchill directed the British war effort. Right. Pretty large area, but the Cabinet War Rooms are this place you can go in and you can see these rooms exactly as they were in, I think it's like 1944. Okay. Radios, beds, maps, charts, place that Churchill slept, the whole nine yards. Okay. They've got 1940s radio piped in, everything. Then around 2009 or 2010, I believe, they opened up a new section called the Churchill War Museum. And it's a museum all about Winston Churchill, which increased the space, probably fivefold. I mean, the total space now is, I would say, I don't know, football field or two, all underground. Okay? I mean, this site is just massive. Okay? And it traces everything about Churchill from his birth to his death, essentially. Well, in one of the rooms in the Churchill War Museum, they have an enigma, okay, Weston Burger. Thank you. They have an enigma machine, okay, and that was the name of the machine that they gave to the Brits used once they finally cracked German code. Okay, that the German high command would communicate cross distances with. They called it the Enigma machine. When code came through that was run through the Enigma machine and was decoded, it spat out the message on a little piece of tape, like ticker tape, okay? That ticker tape was then put in a gold egg that was hand-delivered to Churchill so that he was the only one to see it. I mean, even the guy operating the Enigma machine didn't read it. It was torn off, put in the egg, and walked over to Churchill immediately, whatever time of day, if I remember correctly, whatever time of day that was done. I think that's where she gets this from, okay? Because what we're going to see is, once they get the egg, it's not, woo, we got the egg. Okay, now what's task number two? It's they have to open the egg and find out what is inside. Find the enigma of the riddle inside, okay? So, we're going to skip the actual task because it's not really all that important. Notice, by the way, Harry's task starts on page 353 and ends on page 356. Now, if you've seen the film, which I do remember this part of the film, which had to be 20 or 30 minutes at least. I mean, it was like a fifth or fourth of the movie. It's four pages. But what does the director think? It's four pages where you can have a kid flying against a freaking dinosaur, essentially, a dragon. I mean, this gives you great opportunities for special effects. Where does it all occur? In the novel. That is, Harry against the dragon. Yeah, in the Quidditch pitch. It's all right there. They don't go off to Hogwarts. They're not flying around the lake. They're not knocking towers and tiles off the castle and everything. Okay? Guess you have to spice it up because it's not spicy enough. But notice on 354, after Harry gets his broom, he realizes what he needs to do, and we hear Ludo Bagman. Great Scott, he can fly! Are you watching this, Mr. Crumb? That's a challenge. That's like, Victor, you ever play Quidditch against this kid? Okay, just keep in mind, who's Ludo Bagman? What's he famous for? Yeah, Holy Head Harpies, but he also played for the English national team. As we're going to find out when Harry goes into the Pensieve. When they defeated, what was it, Turkey? I think it was. Okay. In other words, he was a pro. And he's saying, look at this kid. How old's Harry? He's 14. Okay. So, Harry gets his egg. And Ron comes up. Says 358, whoever put your name in that goblet, I reckon they're trying to do you in. It was as though the last few weeks had never happened. As though Harry were meeting Ron for the first time. Right after he'd been made champion. Caught on, have you? Took you long enough. Now, why do you think Harry responds that way? Okay, I mean, think of the situation at the moment. What's going on with Harry physiologically at this moment? Yeah, he is so full of adrenaline. It's like he's had 20 cups of coffee. I mean, he's jacked up, okay? So Ron comes in, cut on, have you? It shouldn't be this little mob, oh. Caught on, have you? Took you long enough. Harry's, you know, he's got to kind of come back down. Hermione stands nervously between them, looking from one to the other. Ron opens his mouth uncertainly. And then Harry says, it's okay, forget it. Ron, no, I should, forget it. Ron grins, Harry grins back. You know, bromance ensues. You can read the slash fiction if you want. I won't go there. They get their march, which I'm skipping. House Elf Liberation Front. I don't think there's anything in that chapter I want to discuss. It's all about blasting and screets. There is a little bit. They meet Winky and Dobby. Dobby's at Hogwarts, which Harry just now discovers. And Winky's down and drunk in the kitchens. They try to get information from Winky, but she won't spill any. And we get the unexpected task. The Yule Ball. It's a dance. What's the task part? What does the word task imply?
Job.
Yeah, like the word taskmaster. Okay. Job. Jobs can be fun. Yeah, it's an unpleasant job. It is something you dread. Okay? So, they've got to find dates. They're 14-year-old boys and 14-year-old girls and below and above. I'm going to skip a bunch. So, Harry, page 397, finally, or 396, finally summons the courage to ask Cho out, Cho Chang. She's always with her little friends and everything. He finally asks her, and 397, she says, oh, I'd really like to, but I'm going with somebody else. He's like, oh, okay. So, he and Ron wait till the last moment. And they finally invite the Patil sisters. Parvati and Padme, or Padma, however you pronounce her name. What kind of names are those?
Indian.
They're Indian. Okay. What do you think the Patil sisters look like? Okay, Indian would be, you know, a natural response. What else? You know, and I don't mean to be crude or anything. Are they ugly? No, they're not.
Something about being the prettiest girl in school.
Yeah, they're supposed to be relatively, let's say, attractive. Okay. What about Harry and Ron? People never really think about that. Probably because we think Rupert Grint, Daniel Radcliffe. Daniel Radcliffe at 11 or 10 wasn't bad for Harry. Problem is, he only grew about another 3 inches. unfortunately for him, he's like 5'3". Okay. Rupert Grint, you know, ended up being like this, so he worked out well. Is Harry supposed to be attractive? You know, his hair's always sticking up back here, no matter what he does. He's skinny, we're told. Ron is gangly. He's like a human Doberman, a human Great Dane. His legs are just kind of moving out. They're not necessarily great catches. I mean, frankly, I think they ought to be happy that the Patil sisters agreed to go with them. Okay? So they go off to the Yule Ball. And page 404, 405, this is before the actual ball. Ron asks Hermione, who are you going to the ball with? She says, I'm not going to tell you because you'll make fun of me. Malfoy's behind and says, you're kidding. Someone's asked that to a ball, not the long-molared mudblood. And Hermione says, oh, hello, Professor Moody. I'll get his name in a moment. Malfoy jumps. And then Ron looks at Hermione, page 405, and says, your teeth. What about them? They're different. Just noticed. Of course they are. You didn't expect me to keep those fangs Malfoy gave me. He goes, no. They're different how they were before you put he put that hex on you. They're straight and normal-sized. Hermione smiles. Well, when I went up to Madame Pomfrey to get them shrunk, she held up a mirror, told me to stop when they were back to how they normally were, and I just let her carry on a bit. Mom and Dad won't be too pleased. I've been trying to persuade them to let me shrink them for ages, but they wanted me to carry on with my braces. That implies that when she got hit with the Dens Agio, she had braces on then. Okay. Harry gets a letter from Sirius. Christmas Day comes. Okay. Page 411, here it is. Dean Thomas says to Harry and Ron, I still can't work out how you two got the best looking girls in the year. Ron, animal magnetism. As he says that gloomily, while he's doing what? Pulling stray threads out of his cuffs. Out of the cuffs of his robe that looks like it's 100 years old, okay, and a girl's. Okay. Page 412, we see Padma and Parvati come down, and top of 412, Parvati was waiting for Harry at the foot of the stairs. She looked very pretty indeed in robes of shocking pink with her long, dark plait braided with gold. Now, that looked pretty cool. Braided with gold and gold bracelets glimmering at her wrists. Keep in mind, her skin is going to be dark. So with the gold, I mean, that's a pretty good accent touch. Harry was relieved to see she wasn't giggling. And he says, you look nice. At least he didn't say you don't look so bad or, you know, something like that. She says, thanks. So they go on down. Parvati says, or Ron says, where's Hermione? Entrance hall, we find out, is packed. They see Padme, who was looking just as pretty as Parvati in robes of bright turquoise. She didn't look too enthusiastic about having Ron as a partner, though. Her dark eyes lingered on the frayed neck and sleeves of his dress robes. Ron, hi. Oh, no. And he hides because Fleur comes in. Skipping a bunch. Page 414. Davies comes in with Fleur. Cedric and Cho come in. Harry and Parvati. And then his eyes fall instead on the girl next to Crumb. His jaw dropped. It was Hermione. But she didn't look like Hermione at all. She had done something with her hair. It was no longer bushy, but sleek and shiny, twisted up into an elegant knot at the back of her head. She's wearing robes made of a floaty, I have no idea how you to visualize floaty, like did she, Wingardium Leviosa on them, so like ghostly? Floaty periwinkle blue material, and she was holding herself differently somehow. Or maybe it was merely the absence of the 20 or so books she usually had slung over her back. Because she carries a book bag, and it's heavy. She's either walking like this all the time, or she's walking kind of hunched over. Now, she's not hunched over. She's standing up straight. She's dressed in a beautiful gown. Her hair's all made up. And she's also smiling. But the reduction in the size of her front teeth was more noticeable than ever. Harry couldn't understand how he hadn't spotted it before. And she says, hi, Harry. Hi, Parvati. Ron walks right past her. Why does Ron walk right past Hermione? Come on, say it. He doesn't recognize her. Okay? What happens once he does recognize her? Page 420. Harry asked Ron, how's it going? Sitting down and opening a bottle of butterbeer. Ron didn't answer. He was glaring at Hermione and Crumb, who were dancing nearby. Padme was sitting with her arms and legs crossed, one foot jiggling in time to the music. Every now and then she threw a disgruntled look at Ron, who was completely ignoring her. Parvati sat down on Harry's other side, crossed her arms, legs too, and within minutes was asked to dance by a boy from Beauxbatons. You don't mind, do you? Showing manners? Harry, what? Well, never mind. And she's gone, okay? Ron gives Hermione a withering look when Hermione comes over. Victor? Hasn't he called you, asked you to call him Vicky yet? What's up with you? If you don't know, I'm not going to tell you. What? He's from Durmstrang. What does he say she's doing? Fraternizing with the enemy. Okay. What does Hermione finally say is the reason Ron is so upset? It doesn't come up here. It comes up a little bit later. She says, you should have asked me out. Why didn't Ron ask Hermione out?
He didn't really see her as, like, a woman or a girl for a while.
Yeah, he'd never really seen her as a girl. He'd seen her as a friend. That's it. Okay? Why else? Okay, he's 14 years old. He's kind of geeky. And what I think, at least, we already know from books two and on, there is an attraction there on Ron's part to Hermione. But he's just never really said anything or even thought about it. Okay? So Harry and Ron go off, and they overhear Hagrid's conversation with Madame Maxime, and at the end of the evening, Cedric asks Harry if he's figured out the next clue. Page 431. He asked Harry, so you know about the golden egg? Does yours wail when you open it? Harry, yeah. Take a bath. What? Take a bath. Take the egg with you. Mull things over in the hot water. It'll help you think. Trust me. Tell you what, use the prefect's bathroom. Just go on in there. Harry's like, yeah, it's kind of weird. Then we get Rita Skeeter's scoop. And we learn what we kind of knew all along, right? About Hagrid. He's half giant. Okay? I'm going to skip a bunch. Bagman's still trying to help Harry. They go off to Hogsmeade, Harry, Ron, and Hermione. And they see Rita Skeeter. And Harry just tears into her. And then Hermione does on 451. You horrible woman, Hermione says. You don't care, do you? Anything for a story, she says. And anyone will do, won't they? Even Ludo Bagman. And Rita Skeeter kind of reads Hermione the Riot Act. I know things about Ludo Bagman that would make your hair curl. Really? What things? Is it the things that Harry sees when he looks in the Pensieve? Is there anything bad, really, in there? No. Okay. So is Rita Skeeter just blowing smoke? Notice, bottom of 431, Ron, she'll be after you next. Okay. Harry, Ron, Hermione go back up to the castle. And they decide to see Hagrid, because Hagrid hasn't been showing up to class. Miss Grubbly Plank has been teaching. And Hermione bangs on the door, says, we're not leaving till you let us in. Dumbledore lets them in. And Harry says, 453, Hagrid, how could you think we'd care with that? Notice he has to kind of pause and think of a word. But that woman wrote about you. Dumbledore, living proof of what I've been telling you, Hagrid. This is going to be important because it goes back to what Hagrid said in Book 2. I've shown you the letters from the countless parents who remember you from their own days here, telling me in no uncertain terms, if I sacked you, they would have something to say about it. In other words, people don't care if Dumbledore has a half-giant teaching there. Okay? Hagrid, not all of them. That is, not all the letters have been positive. Okay. Dumbledore says, if I held out for universal popularity, what should I do? Barricade myself in my study? Refuse to talk to anybody? You're not half giant. Harry, Hagrid, look what I have for relatives. Look at the Dursleys. Now he's seeing the Dursleys. Dumbledore, excellent point. So, I'm expecting you back at work on Monday. Okay? Dumbledore leaves. And Hagrid pulls out a picture of him with his father. His father sitting on his shoulder. Sitting on Hagrid's shoulder. Hagrid was a good 7 or 8 feet tall, judging by the apple tree. So, that was taken just after I got into Hogwarts. So if Hagrid was 7 or 8 feet at 11, and let's say half giants and half wizard males continue growing like the average male will until the age of 18 or so, how tall is Hagrid? I kind of think he's probably about 10 feet tall or so. Okay. Dad was dead chuffed. Thought I might not be a wizard, see? Because me mom, well, never was great shakes at magic, really. But at least he never saw me expelled. Died, see, in me second year. So we have another orphan. We have Harry's an orphan. We have Hagrid's an orphan. Tom Riddle's an orphan. Kind of. Orphan of his own choosing and making. Dumbledore was the one who stuck up for me after Dad went. Got me the gamekeeper job. Trust people, he does. Gives them second chances. That's what sets him apart from other heads, see? He'll accept anyone at Hogwarts as long as they've got the talent. Knows people can turn out okay, even if their families weren't, well, all that respectable. Notice, anyone, he says, can turn out okay, even if their families aren't all that respectable. How does that jive with what Hagrid said in book two about the Malfoys? Bad to the blood. Rotten blood. Family's not respectable in that sense. But some don't understand that. There's some who'd always hold it against you. Yeah, there's some who'd even pretend they just, and he goes off about Madame Maxime. And he concludes with, you know what I'd love, Harry? I'd love you to win. I really would. It'd show them all. You don't have to be pure blood to do it. You don't have to be ashamed of what you are. It'd show them Dumbledore's the one who's got it right, letting anyone in as long as they can do magic. Okay? The egg in the eye. Harry goes on off to the bathroom, listens to the eye. He's got, you know, Moaning Myrtle to deal with as the Peeping Tom ghost. She's creepy. Comes out under his cloak. Almost gets caught by Snape. Mad-Eye rescues him. Harry shows him the map, and Mad-Eye asks to borrow it. Okay. Harry told him he's seen Mr. Crouch on the map. Then we have the second task, which I'm going to skip a bunch of. Harry's the first one to get down to the hostages, but he's the last one to arrive back to the top of the lake. Why?
Because he rescued all the other hostages.
He didn't just take Ron up. Why? I mean, you're exactly right. He waited to make sure everybody was rescued safely. Why? Okay. Why else? Dumbledore says it's, you know, moral fiber. Did Harry listen at the beginning of the school year when they talked about the Triwizard Tournament?
I didn't really think, I wouldn't have. If you didn't think there was any possibility of you participating.
Okay. That's a good response. What does the clue in the egg, what does the mer-lady or merman sing in the little rhyme? What's going to happen to the thing you love most if you don't rescue them within an hour? They'll be lost to you forever. When Harry discovers Ron's missing, he's thinking, oh no. Ron will be dead. Even though they were told at the beginning of the year, no one will die. Okay? So he goes down. He gets to all four of them first. Crumb arrives shortly thereafter. Okay? Cedric arrives. Gets Hermione. Florinel never makes it. Harry's sitting there, you know, kind of looking at the watch. And he finally fights, Gabrielle, fights off the mer people as he takes Gabrielle and Ron back up to the top. Okay? And he gets second place in that one because, as I said, they say he shows moral fiber because he won't return until he makes sure they all live. Okay, moral fiber. Chapter 27. We have another scoop from Rita Skeeter. This one's about his broken heart over Hermione, who has given her heart to somebody else. Harry has potions with Snape for 516, 517. And Snape threatens him with Veritas serum. And just before Harry leaves, he sees Karkaroff burst into the room, and he shows Snape something on his arm and says, "It's getting brighter. You must have noticed." Okay? They go to Hogsmeade. They meet Sirius in the cave. And Harry's like, "What are you doing here?" Top of 522, "Fulfilling my duty as godfather," says Sirius. "Don't worry, I'm pretending to be a lovable stray." Okay? Dumbledore knows he's there, blah, 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 blah. They let him know that Barty Crouch is no longer coming to the Triwizard Tournament and that he fired his house elf, page 523. Okay? So, Sirius starts looking at the events of the Quidditch Cup from a logical perspective. He says, "You first saw the elf in the top box, right? Saving a seat for Crouch." "Harry, yep." "But Crouch didn't turn up." "Nope." "Okay. Did you check your pockets for your wand after you left the top box?" "No, I didn't." "What did Harry assume?" "That he dropped it in the forest as they were making their way to the forest, trying to get away from the Death Eaters." Okay, what possibility is Sirius raising? "It got taken when you were in the top box." "Hermione, Winky didn't steal that wound. Elf wasn't the only one in that box. Who else was sitting behind you?" "Loads of people," says Harry. "Bulgarian ministers, Fudge, the Malfoys, Ron." "The Malfoys. Anyone else?" "No." "Well, Ludo Bagman." Okay. Harry mentioned, you know, Ludo Bagman's trying to cheat and help him. They talk about the Dark Mark being created. And Hermione goes on about Winky being sacked, page 525. And Ron says, "Hermione, would you give it a break? Give it a rest with the elf?" And Sirius says, "She's got the measure of Crouch better than you have, Ron." And then he makes this very interesting little statement. "If you want to know what a man's like, take a good look at how he treats his inferiors, not his equals." How does Malfoy treat his inferiors? As inferior. As worthless. Okay. How does Vernon Dursley treat his inferiors? Pretty much the same way. How does Dumbledore treat his inferiors? As equals. Okay. How does Sirius treat his inferiors? His inferior. I mean, we're going to hear him talk about Snape in just a moment. He considers Snape to be his inferior. So he says these absences of Barty Crouch don't make sense. After all he did to reinstate the Triwizard Tournament. "Harry, so you know Crouch then?" "Sirius, oh, I know Crouch all right. He was the one who gave the order for me to be sent to Azkaban without a trial." "What? You're kidding." "No, I'm not. Crouch used to be head of the Department of Magical Law Enforcement. Didn't you know?" They shake their heads. "He was tipped for to be the next Minister of Magic. Great wizard, Barty Crouch. Powerfully magical." What does that mean? It means full of magic. I mean, he is a really powerful wizard. And power hungry. Do you think being head of the department, where'd it go, of magical law enforcement is enough? Oh, not a Voldemort supporter. No, Barty Crouch was always very outspoken against the dark side. But then a lot of people who were against the dark side, well, you wouldn't understand. You're too young. Again, to hear that. Ron, you know, it's what my dad said at the World Cup. Why don't you try us? Try us, why don't you? A grin flashes across Sirius's face. Why? What's the grin mean? That's Sirius going, way to go, Ron. Step up. All right, I'll try you. In other words, how's he going to treat them? Like 14-year-olds? No. Because what else could you take? Oh, well, you wouldn't understand. You're too young to mean. You're inferior. Ron says, try us, why don't you? Way to go, Ron. Make yourself my equal. Okay. All right. And listen to what he describes. Imagine Voldemort's powerful now. You don't know who his supporters are. You don't know who's working for him and who isn't. You know he can control people so that they do terrible things without being able to stop themselves. You're scared for yourself, your family, your friends. Every week, news comes of more deaths, more disappearances, more torturing. Ministry of Magic's in disarray. They don't know what to do. They're trying to help everything, keep everything hidden from the Muggles. Meanwhile, Muggles are dying too. Terror everywhere. Panic. Confusion. Imagine for a moment 9/11 happened on 9/12, 9/13, 9/14, 9/15, 9/16. That was the fear that was going to happen. Okay? I mean, it was a very palpable, strong fear. It was just, when's the next shoe going to drop? Okay? This is what Harry is expecting the world to be like when we open book 5. Because at the end of this book, we see Voldemort come back. Full physical body. And Harry's expecting death and destruction, mayhem, torturings, all hell breaking loose. And it's not happening. That happens in book 6. Okay? So, times like that bring out the best in some people and the worst in others. What was one of the corollary fears? You guys were too young to remember. One of the corollary fears after 9/11. It wasn't not only other planes are going to be hijacked or trains are going to be blown up or other places of mass amounts of people are going to be blown up. It was also, what is the United States government, law enforcement, military going to do in reaction? I mean, there was all kinds of fear that George Bush, that crazy West Texan, was going to go off half-cocked and was going to nuke somebody. Okay? Or was going to give the CIA or whatever other branch, carte blanche to do whatever it damn well pleased. Well, times like that bring out the best in some people and the worst in others. Crouch's principles might have been good in the beginning. I wouldn't know. He rose quickly through the ministry, and he started ordering very harsh measures against Voldemort's supporters. How harsh? Orders were given new powers, powers to kill rather than capture, for instance. Okay. You know, there is great fear about President Bush and how he would respond. And then, you know, even after the Iraq War started, I mean, Bush would still every now and then make comments like, you know, it's either us or them. you know, come and get me kind of a thing. In fact, he did this come and get me kind of a thing one time, and Laura Bush kind of slapped him upside the head, proverbially. Said, now, Georgie, we're not in, you know, the Wild West days. Okay? And he had to tone it back a little bit. Bush did allow, did authorize, you know, enhanced interrogation techniques. But, you know, none of those people died that the CIA interrogated. There's been an entire change of focus between what Bush ordered and allowed and what President Obama has ordered and allowed. Because whereas we grabbed and interrogated people under the Bush presidency, what has Obama done and taken to an art form?
Drone strikes.
No interrogation. Just kill the bastards. And not always the right bastards. I mean, wedding parties, where we know, I mean, oops, not a group of terrorists, a wedding party where 20 or 30 people full of children just wiped off the face of the earth, okay? Look at what Crouch says here, what Remus says. Orders were given new powers, powers to kill rather than capture, for instance. And I wasn't the only one who was handed straight to the Dementors without trial. Crouch fought violence with violence and authorized the use of the unforgivable curses against suspects. What does that mean? If the suspect could be caught, they could be what? Imperiest? Crucified? Cruciatus? I would say he became as ruthless and cruel as many on the dark side. But notice, was he a Voldemort supporter? No! Does that mean he was necessarily good then? No! As Sirius is going to tell them, I don't think I have this mark, somewhere in this book, the world isn't divided between Death Eaters and good people. You know, there's a whole continuum. Maybe good people, you know, Mother Teresa over here and Voldemort over here. You know, and it's just where the pendulum falls. Okay? He had his supporters, mind you, plenty of people thought he was going about things the right way. And there were a lot of witches and wizards clamoring for him to take over as Minister of Magic. Because, you know, think of the mindset. He's doing what? Keeping us safe. Okay? What did Barty Crouch say, middle of Chamber of Secrets, when he went down to Hagrid's hut? Gotta be seen doing something.
Fudge?
Yeah, sorry, Fudge, not Barty Crouch. When Voldemort disappeared, it looked like only a matter of time till Crouch got the top job. But then his son was caught with a group of Death Eaters who'd managed to talk their way out of Azkaban. Apparently, they were trying to find Voldemort and return him to power. What would this be like? This would be like today, you know, Obama's oldest daughter showing up on an internet video saying, I'm going off to Syria to join ISIS. I mean, just pause for a moment to think about that. What would the effect of that be? Okay, you'd have the one group of whack jobs who say he's not an American to begin with. Okay, and who say he's actually closet Muslim, Manchurian candidate kind of a thing. They'd be going, see, told you, we ought to. What else would be going on? I mean, imagine the uproar that would create in America. All right? Nasty little shock for old Barty. Right, imagine? And then Sirius gives two little pieces of advice. Not to Barty Crouch, because it's too late. should have spent a bit more time at home with his family, shouldn't he? Ought to have left the office early once in a while, gotten to know his son. Why? Did he say that he knows for sure Barty Crouch Jr. was a Death Eater? Nope. He was apprehended in the presence of Death Eaters. So why? What does Sirius mean? Should have spent a bit more time at home with his family. Or let me put it this way. Why do you think J.K. Rowling puts those two sentences in there? Because keep in mind, she is the author. What might she be suggesting by including those? Because that isn't the first bit of parenting advice that she includes in this book. What happened when Harry left the Dursleys? Bye. He walks off to the fireplace, and Mr. Weasley stops him. Why? What did the Dursleys say?
Nothing.
Nothing. Total silence. Right? And we get that description, you know. Vernon's having a problem being taught consideration by a man who blew up half his living room. So what does that tell us? The narrator tells us, Vernon takes that to mean that this oddball weirdo is trying to teach him to be considerate, okay, towards Harry. He says, you're not going to see him till next summer. Aren't you going to say goodbye? He's teaching what? Manners. Okay? Here we have then Sirius say, you know, maybe you shouldn't spend so much time at the office. Maybe you should get home every now and then to see your children, to talk to your children, to get to know your children. Otherwise, your children might what?
Become terrorists.
That's right, become terrorists. Go off and join ISIS, you know. We're going to see Dumbledore do essentially the same thing in Book 6 to the Dursleys. Harry, was his son a Death Eater? No idea. But he talks about him being there, Sirius being there, when the son was brought in, etc. Harry and Hermione, or Hermione, did Crouch try and get his son off? I thought you had the measure of him. He let his son off? Are you kidding? It tied him to dark magic. Harry, he gave his own son to the Dementors? That's right. Harry, so he's still there? No, he's not there anymore. He died about a year after they brought him in. Okay. Page 529 at the bottom. So old Crouch lost it all just when he thought he had it made. In other words, he had his hand on that brass ring. One moment, a hero poised to become Minister of Magic. Next, son dead, wife dead, family name dishonored, and a big drop of popularity. Once the boy died, people started feeling a bit more sympathetic toward the son, started asking how a nice young lad from a good family had gone so badly astray. Ah, good family means what? Diddly squat. Okay? What did Dumbledore tell Harry at the end of Book 2? It is our choices, Harry, far more than our abilities, that show what we truly are. Okay? Well, what kind of choices did Barty Crouch Jr. make? To quote the old knight from Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, he chose poorly. Sirius says, the conclusion was that his father never cared for him. So Cornelius Fudge got the top job. Okay. So they talk about Snape for a while. Page 531, Siri says, ever since I found out Snape was teaching here, I've wondered why Dumbledore hired him. Snape's always been fascinated by the dark arts. He was famous for it at school. Slimy, oily, greasy-haired kid he was. Think Snape's his inferior? Snape knew more curses when he arrived at school than half the kids in seventh year. And he was part of a gang of Slytherins who nearly all turned out to be Death Eaters. And he holds up his fingers and he starts naming them. Rozier and Wilkes, both killed by Orcs the year before Voldemort fell. The Lestranges, they're a married couple, they're in Azkaban. Avery, he wormed his way out of trouble, he's still at large. Okay. Harry tells Sirius about Karkaroff and the thing on his arm. And Harry asks, Snape asks, top of 533, in response to Sirius asking Ron if he could find out anything about Barty Crouch's absences. And then he tells him he might try and find out whether they've got any leads on Bertha Jorkins while you're at it. Harry says Bagman told me they hadn't. Okay. So he tells them to go off back to school. We get the next chapter, The Madness of Mr. Crouch. Harry goes off with... let me back up for a moment. Hermione gets hate mail. And they get a letter back from Percy saying Mr. Crouch is taking a well-deserved break, etc. Harry's off in the forest with Crumb after Bagman tells them about the third task, the maze. Crumb asks for a moment. And what does Crumb want to talk to Harry about? 552 and following. I want to know what there is between you and Hermione.
Harry's like, what?
Nothing. We're friends. Not my girlfriend, never has been. Just that Skeeter woman making things up. Hermione talks about you very often. Yeah, we're friends. You have never, you have not. No, you fly very well. I was watching at the first task. Harry, thanks. I saw you at the Quidditch World Cup. And they hear something in the trees behind them, and suddenly Barty Crouch jumps out. Just blinkered, just completely mad. Says he's done something awful, he needs to get to Dumbledore. Harry leaves him with Crumb, goes up to tell Dumbledore. Leads them back down where they find Crumb, stupefied. Crumb opens his eyes, tells him that he was attacked. Okay. and Harry goes back up to the school. We get the next chapter of the dream where Harry has the dream when he's in divination. Gets a letter from Sirius. And when he finishes the dream, he decides to go off and tell Dumbledore. He overhears Fudge talking with Moody and Dumbledore. They're going to take Fudge down to show him where Crouch was. So Harry's left in Dumbledore's office by himself. And he sees a cabinet on the wall. And there's a kind of eerie glowing light from it, and the door's open so he can go look. And notice as he looks, this milky white kind of stuff kind of goes clear. And as he gets closer, he sees a room in there. It's kind of like Mirror of Galadriel. And he looks around because he can see people in the room, but he can't see the corners of the room because the basin is round. So he gets close to try to look into the corners. His nose touches the water, or whatever it is, and he's inside. He looks to his side, and there's Dumbledore next to him, who doesn't speak. And there he sees Igor Karkaroff brought in, set down to a chained chair with Dementors by him. And he hears Karkaroff start naming names. And he gives one that they seem very interested in, Rookwood, page 590. He gives a bunch they already know about. And he says, no, wait, I have more. Snape. Harry's like, yes. Snape. Snape has been cleared by this council. He's been vouched for by Albus Dumbledore. No. Snape is a Death Eater. Dumbledore stands. I've given evidence already on this matter. Severus Snape was indeed a Death Eater. However, he rejoined our side before Lord Voldemort's downfall. Why is that important? What if he turned after Voldemort fell? Gee, a lot of danger there, right? But the fact is, he turned before Voldemort fell, and what does Dumbledore say? He turned spy for us at great personal risk. That implies he maintained his cover as a Death Eater. He went back into Voldemort's presence while a spy for Dumbledore. Okay? So Karkaroff leaves. Next person brought in, you know, screen goes blank as it were, Ludo Bagman. But not the Ludo Bagman that Harry's familiar with, who's kind of old and fat. This is Ludo Bagman when? At the height of his Quidditch career. You know, I don't know how in shape you need to be for Quidditch, especially as a beater. I mean, I imagine he's kind of large, as it were, okay? Why does Ludo Bagman get off? Page 393.
Because he's so popular.
Yeah. Crouch puts it to a vote. Because what does Bagman say? Rookwood was a friend of my dad's. He said he could get me a job in the ministry. I can't keep getting hit in the head by bludgers, you know. I mean, there's all the news about, you know, NFL quarterbacks and concussions and such. So, Crouch says it'll be put to the vote. And it gets a unanimous vote not to be condemned. Okay? Not one person raises their hand to imprison him. But one witch stands up. We'd just like to congratulate Mr. Bagman on his splendid performance for England in the Quidditch match against Turkey last Saturday. Crouch is furious. Despicable. Rookwood, get him a job indeed. The day Ludo Bagman joins us will be a very sad day for the ministry. And now, we've got Barty Crouch working side by side with Ludo Bagman. So, scene goes dark, comes back up. Now four chairs are brought in. And four people. Father! Father! And Harry sees young Barty Crouch. And Crouch doesn't listen. He just reads the law right over him. Dumbledore taps him on the shoulder, takes him back to his office. And he tells Harry, Harry asks, what is this? He says, it's a pensieve. Notice the little play on words. It's a pensieve to be used when Dumbledore is pensive. Full of thoughts. Thinking a lot. Pens from the French pensée, meaning thoughts. Okay? Dumbledore says, like you, I sometimes find I have simply too many thoughts and memories crammed in my mind. And Harry's because he never really has too many thoughts. And Dumbledore takes his wand, holds it up to his temple, and this milky stuff kind of comes out, and he puts it in and swirls it. Okay? And what does he see? He sees Snape. It's coming back, Carcross 2. Okay? Harry explains why he looked in, and Dumbledore says, 598, curiosity is not a sin. But we should exercise caution with our curiosity. Yes, indeed. How many of you have read Jurassic Park? It's a much better book than it is a film, by the way. I feel like I need to say that about every movie, every book that's made into a movie. I've got a t-shirt that says the book is better. They do, I mean, that's one film where they do stick fairly close to the book. But there's a great scene where Ian Malcolm is talking with John Hammond and the others. They're in the dining area. And Ian Malcolm says, you know, that's the problem, John. You never asked the question, should we? You and your scientists, all you're concerned about is playing God with this DNA. You never stop and ask the question, should I? Okay? You just full bore. Dumbledore, curiosity is not a sin, but we should exercise caution with curiosity. And that's not science fiction, by the way. The whole idea about, you know, gene splicing and adding genes from one species to another species in order to fill out the genetic makeup. That's not science fiction. Scientists just this year, I don't know what you call it, rejuvenated, a 30,000-year-old bacteria from the Siberian tundra. One that had been brought out of an ice core, brought it back to life. Okay. They're still working on the mastodons, which they've only been dead 10,000 years, but, you know, you never know. So, we see Bertha Jorkins come up. And Harry says, Bertha? Yes. So, Harry says, I wanted to tell you something, and he tells Dumbledore about the dream. And what did he see in the dream? Voldemort got a letter from an owl. He said Wormtail's blunder had been repaired. He said someone was dead, but Wormtail wouldn't be fed to the snake. Okay? So Harry finally asks him, do you know why my scar is hurting me? Dumbledore says, I have an idea. It's that when your scar hurts you, both when Voldemort is near you, and when he's feeling a particularly strong surge of hatred. Why? Because you and he are connected by that scar. It's no ordinary scar. Harry, so you think the dream, it really happened? It's possible. Did you see Voldemort? No. Just the back of his chair. But there wouldn't have been anything to see, would there? Dumbledore, how indeed? Because Harry says, how could he be able to want? Do you think he's getting stronger? Voldemort? The years of Voldemort's ascent to power were marked with disappearances. And Dumbledore starts naming them. Bertha Jorkins has vanished without a trace in the place where Voldemort was certainly known to be last. Mr. Crouch has disappeared. So there's two. They're both ministry officials. And he says, and there's a third disappearance which the ministry doesn't care about. Why? Because it's a muggle. But this guy's kind of interesting. This person disappeared from the very village where Voldemort's father grew up. And he's not been seen since last August. These disappearances seem to me to be linked. Ministry disagrees. Harry, that thing I was in the Pensieve, could I ask you about that? You could. The one with Crouch's son? 602, were they talking about Neville's parents? Has Neville never told you why he's been brought up by his grandmother? Harry shakes his head. Yes, they were talking about Neville's parents. His father, Frank, was an Auror, just like Professor Moody. He and his wife were tortured for information about Voldemort's whereabouts after he lost his powers. So they're dead? No. They are insane. They are both in St. Mungo's Hospital for magical maladies and injuries. I believe Neville visits them with his grandmother during the holidays. They do not recognize him. I don't think that's true. As you'll see when we get to Order of the Phoenix. I think Neville's mother does recognize him. Because of one thing that happens. The Longbottoms are very popular. Attacks on them came after Voldemort's fall from power. He says those attacks caused a wave of fury, such as I have never known. What does that mean, a wave of fury? People wanted the killers, the torturers dead. But the Longbottoms couldn't really give evidence. So Mr. Crouch's son might not have been involved? Dumbledore, no idea. Mr. Bagman, never accused of dark activity, nor has Professor Snape. What made you think he'd really stop supporting Voldemort? And Dumbledore doesn't answer, just says that's a matter between Professor Snape and myself. Okay. So we get the third task. Page 607. Harry goes up to his dormitory, gets into bed, and you imagine how it must feel to a parent still living but unable to recognize you. He often got sympathy from strangers for being an orphan. But as he listened to Neville's snores, he thought that Neville deserved it more than he did. Lying in the darkness, Harry felt a rush of anger and hate toward the people who had tortured Mr. and Mrs. Longbottom. He remembered the jeers of the crowd as Crouch's son and his companions had been dragged from the court by the Dementors. He understood how they felt. Then he remembered the milk-white face of the screaming boy and realized with a jolt he had died a year later. And what does Harry come back to? It's Voldemort. Voldemort is the cause of all these broken families. Okay? So we get a new Rita Skeeter article about Harry Potter being disturbed and dangerous. Why? Because he had a dream in Trelawney's class and had fits. Okay? And Hermione starts to wonder, how could she have known that? Where could Rita Skeeter have gotten that information? So, Harry goes off to the meeting with the families before the final Triwizard Tournament, and the Weasleys are there. Since he doesn't have parents, the Weasleys show up. And he goes into the task, and I'm going to skip everything that happens in the task. He and Cedric get within reach of the cup. Page 632. Cedric is standing feet from the Triwizard Cup, which is gleaming behind him. Harry, who's been bitten and dropped, says to Cedric, take it, go on, take it. You're there. But Cedric doesn't move. He looks at Harry and he turns and stares at the cup. Harry saw the longing expression on his face in its gold light. In other words, Cedric wants that cup more than anything. I mean, think of the glory Hufflepuff would have. You take it, Cedric says. You should win. It's twice you've saved my neck in here. Harry, it's not how it's supposed to work. The one who reaches the cup first gets the points. That's you. Take it. No. Stop being noble, says Harry. Just take it, then we can get out of here. Why does Harry say, then we can get out of here? What's he probably thinking?
He's wanting to be over.
Keep going. He's in pain.
Oh.
You know, I can get this fixed. Cedric, you told me about the dragons. I would have gone down in the first task if you hadn't told me what was coming. Harry, I had help too. You helped me with the leg. Notice, trying to mop up his bloody leg with his robes. You know, I can't help but think of Monty Python. You helped me with the egg. We're square. Cedric, I had help on the egg in the first place. We're still square. Cedric, you should have got more points on the second task. You stayed behind to get all the hostages. I should have done that. Harry, I was the only one who was thick enough to take the song seriously. Take the cup. No. He stepped over the spider's tangled legs to join Harry, who stared at him. Cedric was serious. He was walking away from the sort of glory Hufflepuff House hadn't had in centuries. What's Cedric doing?
Being
a quintessential Hufflepuff. Because they are just, loyal, and fair. He's choosing humility over glory. Go on, says Cedric. And then Harry says, both of us. We'll do it together. Hogwarts will still get the glory. Okay? They touch it, boom, it's a port key. They're not aware of that, however. So, Harry asks when they arrive at the cemetery. Anyone tell you it was a port key? Nope. Part of the task? Don't know. Cedric, one's out. Harry, yeah. Notice, Harry's kind of thinking, been in these situations before. Yeah. So they pull out their wands. They hear someone coming. A hooded cloak arrives, and it's carrying something. And the thing in the hooded cloak's arms looks like a baby or a bundle of robes. Page 637. The figure stops beside a towering marble headstone, 6 feet from them. Okay. Headstone. Okay. 6 feet. Harry, Cedric. And then without warning, Harry's scar exploded with pain. It was agony such as he had never felt before. His wand slipped from his fingers and he put his hands over his face. His knees buckled. He's on the ground. He could see nothing at all. His head was about to split open. He hears from far away, kill the spear. Avada Kedavra, a blast of green light blazed through Harry's eyelids. Eyes are still closed. And he heard something heavy fall to the ground beside him. Standing. Cedric's taller. And he's dead. He's got X's for his eyes. Okay? But he's still beside him. In other words, it's still 6 feet. Cedric was lying spread-eagled on the ground beside him. He was dead. The short man in the cloak had put down his bundle, lit his wand, drags Harry to the marble headstone. So now we get Harry. And he has rope tied around him, but he's still at the headstone. Cedric is still 6 feet away. Until you go to page 639, and right smack exact in the middle of the page, and Cedric's body is now lying some 20 feet away. How the hell did that happen?
Magic.
Yeah, magic. It's just like, you know, the little mice in the Lion, Witch in the Wardrobe that come up and untie Aslan and they get underneath and move them away. This is horrible copying. It's the only explanation. And bad writing. She should have known. Previous page. Head Cedric is 6 feet away. Because nothing in the intervening two paragraphs says anything about Cedric's body being moved. And it doesn't say Cedric fell 14 feet away from Harry. Avada Kedavra, blasted him. No, because he falls beside Harry. I don't know what universe 14 feet away is beside. It's not. Okay? Some way beyond him, there's the glittering Triwizard Cup. What? The Triwizard Cup was where Harry and Cedric were. Trying to see. Hold on. Just double checking. Harry's looking around the graveyard. It doesn't say he's walking. He's looking. Nowhere from when they arrived there, having touched the Triwizard Cup, nowhere does it say they ever move from the point that the Triwizard Cup takes them. Why? Because it's designed to take them here. That's all part of the grand plan. So, here he hears noises at his feet. He sees the snake, etc., etc. He sees Wormtail set up the big cauldron. He hears the voice, "Hurry, now!" Wormtail pulls open the robes on the ground, revealing what was inside them, and Harry let out a yell that was strangled in the wad of material blocking his mouth. We're never told what it is, but we get a little indication in Book 7 when Harry goes off to King's Cross towards the end of the novel, when he sees this thing sitting under a seat that looks all burned and raw and red. And Harry wants to move away from it, but he's drawn towards it because he wants to help it, even there. Here, the thing had the shape of a crouched human child, except Harry had never seen anything less like a child. Hairless, scaly looking, dark, raw, reddish black. Arms and legs thin and feeble, its face flat and snake-like, with gleaming red eyes. And Wormtail starts his nice little black mass. Bone of the father, unknowingly given, you will renew your son. And he, okay. And white stuff starts to come out of the ground in front of the tombstone. Flesh of the servant will be willingly given, you will revive your master. Pulls out a knife, off with the wrist. The blood of the enemy, forcibly taken, you will resurrect your foe. Drops it in. And Harry's thinking, please. And Voldemort rises up out of the cauldron. 6:45. Wormtail. My lord, you promised. Hold out your arm. Oh, thank you, master. He holds out the arm with the stump. The other arm, Wormtail. Master, please, please. And he sees the dark mark. Okay. He presses his long white forefinger to the brand on Wormtail's arm. Harry's scar explodes again. And Voldemort starts to talk. Talks about his father, talks about his mother. Wormtail keeps begging. Why? Because he's sitting there and his blood is. Death Eaters all come. Okay. And Wormtail, Voldemort just keeps on talking. Page 648, back up. Voldemort's talking about how could they have believed I would not rise again? They who knew the steps I took long ago to guard myself against mortal death. Here's a question for you. Did they know all the steps he took? Sure as hell hope not. I mean, you're going to tell people like Wormtail about Horcruxes? Not a smart idea. They who had seen proofs of the immensity of my power, and I answer myself, perhaps they believed a still greater power could exist. Dumbledore, etc. And one of them falls forward and says, Master, forgive, forgive, you know, and he Crucio's poor Avery. We're going to see Avery crucioed a couple other times. Okay. Wormtail still just blubbering. He missed it. Okay. And so what does Voldemort do? He gives Wormtail a silver hand, which works just like his regular hand. And we finally see Voldemort go around and start naming the Death Eaters. Lucius, my slippery friend, told you've not renounced the old ways. And Malfoy just lies through his teeth. You know, I was constantly on the alert. Had there been any sign, blah, 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 blah. The Lestranges, he says, should stand here. They're in Azkaban. They'll be freed. McNair, you had to know this guy was a dirty, rotten bastard. Crabbe, Goyle, of course they're going to be there. I mean, where there's a Malfoy, there's a Crabbe and Goyle. Not. All right. He says, and here we have six missing Death Eaters. Three dead in my service. I can't remember. They were the ones that Sirius talked about. Rozier and Wilkes. There's another one that he hasn't named. Was it Mulciber or is Mulciber coming up? I think it's Mulciber. Three dead in my service. One too cowardly to return. He will pay. One who I believe has left me forever. He will be killed. And then my faithful servant. Okay? So, without going into all of it, Voldemort gives this big long spiel about why it was he couldn't touch the boy, 652. His mother left upon him the traces of her sacrifice. This is old magic. I should have remembered it. I was foolish to overlook it. But no matter, I can touch him now. And he touches Harry. I miscalculated, my friends, I admit it. My curse was deflected by the woman's foolish sacrifice. It rebounded upon myself. Talks about the pain, where he went. And then he mentions 4 years ago, the means for my return seemed assured. That is, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. He keeps talking, and he says, 656. So, I would have to resettle for my old body back again. I knew that to achieve this, it's an old piece of dark magic, the potion that revived me tonight. I would need three powerful ingredients. One of them was already at hand, was it not, Wormtail, flesh given by a servant? My father's bone naturally means I had to come here. But he said, for the other, for the blood of an enemy, I wanted Harry Potter's blood. I wanted the blood of the one who had stripped me of power 13 years ago. Why? For the lingering protection his mother once gave him would then reside in my veins too. In other words, he would be protected. Ah, but how to get at Harry Potter? So he goes on. He tells us about Bertha Jorkins, etc. And he says, now in time, Wormtail, give him back his wand. Why? Because Voldemort has got to prove to the rest of the Death Eaters that he is stronger than Harry Potter. So, 659. You've been taught how to duel, Harry Potter? When was Harry taught how to duel? And by whom? Second book. By Gilderoy Lockhart. This is not a fair fight. By any stroke of the imagination. Harry's thinking, all I know is the disarming spell. And what use would it be to deprive Voldemort of his wand when he's surrounded by Death Eaters? We bow to each other, Harry. Harry doesn't bow. Come, the niceties must be observed. Page 660. Dumbledore would like you to show manners. Bow to death, Harry. And Harry just stands straight. I said, bow. Raises his wand, and Harry feels his back. This isn't an imperious curse. Okay? Very good. And now you face me like a man, straight-backed and proud, the way your father did. And now we duel. And Voldemort puts him under a Cruciatus curse. And then stops. He says, "That hurt, didn't it, Harry? You don't want me to do that again, do you?" And Harry's thinking, "I'm going to die like Cedric." Page 661 or 51? 61, I think. Those pitiless red eyes were telling him so. He was going to die, and there was nothing he could do about it. But he wasn't going to play along. He wasn't going to obey Voldemort. He wasn't going to beg. "I asked you whether you want me to do that again. Answer me. Imperio." Well, Harry's been taught how to put off the Imperius curse. "I won't." And these words burst from Harry's mouth. They echoed through the graveyard, and the dream state was lifted as suddenly as though cold water had been thrown over him. Back rushed the aches that the Cruciatus curse had left all over his body. "You won't," says Voldemort. And notice, the Death Eaters aren't laughing now. Think any of them can put it off? "You won't say no? Harry, obedience is a virtue I need to teach you before you die. Perhaps another little dose of pain." And Harry jumps behind the tombstone. "We're not playing hide and seek, Harry. You cannot hide from me. Does this mean you're tired of our duel? You don't want to die? It might be painless. I would not know. I've never died." And we're told there was no hope, no help to be had. And as he heard Voldemort draw nearer still, he knew one thing only, and it was beyond fear or reason. He was not going to die crouching here like a child playing hide and seek. He was not going to die kneeling at Voldemort's feet. He was going to die. He was going to die upright like his father, and he was going to die trying to defend himself, even if no defense was possible. Harry yells Expelliarmus, Voldemort yells Avada Kedavra, and the jolts of light meet and kind of ricochet all out, making this web, this chain of light, deep gold. And Harry feels his feet lifted from the ground, and he and Voldemort are raised, and they're moved elsewhere. Voldemort yells, "Do nothing." And Harry sees his eyes wide with astonishment. Why? Does Voldemort know what's happening? And saw him fighting to break the thread of light still connecting his wand with Harry's. Harry held onto his wand more tightly with both hands, and the golden thread remained unbroken. Okay? And then Harry hears Phoenix song. The sound of hope. The most beautiful and welcome thing he'd ever heard in his life. It was the sound he connected with Dumbledore, and it was almost as though a friend were speaking in his ear. "Don't break the connection." "Harry, I know." Notice, it's not the voice that tells him don't break the connection that Harry knows. It's somehow he internally knows, don't let this connection break. And he sees the beads of light. Right? And they're coming towards his wand. And he's like, don't really think I want that to happen. And he starts to concentrate. And he forces the beads of light the other direction. And as they get closer and closer to Voldemort's wand, his wand now is vibrating extra hard. That is, Voldemort's wand is doing this. And Voldemort looks astonished and fearful. And one of the beads of light is just inches. And Harry didn't understand why he was doing it, didn't know what it might achieve, but he now concentrated as he never had before, and it connects. And what happens? Voldemort's wand starts to emit echoing screams of pain. And then Voldemort's wide eyes widen with shock, as what happens? The ghost of the hand he had made Wormtail. More shouts of pain, and then something much larger comes out. Head, chest, arms, torso of Cedric Diggory. It's almost like the wand is giving birth to these things. If ever Harry might have released the wand, his wand from shock, it would have been then. And we're told the thick gray ghost of Cedric Diggory. Was it a ghost? It looked so solid. And spoke. Hold on, Harry. Okay. It's Cedric's ghost. Cedric is where?
Dead.
Lying over here by this thing still. Well, we don't know exactly where at this point. Yeah, or 20 feet away. So 6 to 20 feet. Yeah. And yet this thing says, hold on, Harry. What tense is that? That's right now, present tense. Okay. Harry looks at Voldemort. Voldemort's scared, you know what, less. More screams of pain from the wand. Something else emerges. A hand. And then an old man comes out. He was a real wizard then. Killed me, that one did. You fight him, boy. Notice, two verb tenses there. Past tense, was, killed, you fight. Now, present tense. This is Frank Bryce. Where's Frank Bryce? He'd been dead a long time. Okay. And yet, Frank Bryce's ghost is speaking present tense. Another head comes out. It's Bertha Jorkins. Don't let go now. Don't let him get you, Harry. Don't let go. Bertha Jorkins just pops out of the wand and she immediately knows this is Harry. She immediately recognizes Harry. Huh. She and the other two shadowy figures began to pace around the inner walls of the Golden Web while the Death Eaters flit around the outside. Voldemort's dead victims whisper as they circled the duelers, whispering words of encouragement to Harry, and we don't know what to Voldemort. Dirty, sour, slimy. Another head starts to come out. Harry knew who it was. When he saw it, he knew who it would be. Smoky shadow of a young woman with long hair fell to the ground as Bertha had done. Now, if you have a first printing of the first edition of this, it's not his mother. It's his father that comes out. But you mix it up. He knew as he had expected it from the moment. And what happens? She looks at Harry and says, your father's coming. Hold on for your father. It will be all right. Hold. What? Does, you know, he have to put money to get in through the queue or something? What do you mean your father's coming? He is the wand, you know, like the TARDIS, bigger on the inside than it is on the outside? Is this, you know, is Doctor Who inside? And he came, first his head, then his body, tall and untidy haired like Harry. The smoky, shadowy form of James Potter blossomed from the end of Voldemort's wand, fell to the ground. And this is the kicker. When the connection is broken, we will linger for only moments, but we will give you time. You must get to the portkey. How the hell does James know there's a portkey? No, it's not magic. It will return you to Hogwarts. Do you understand? Have they been having a tea party inside the wand? And Cedric says, dirty rotten bastard, kill me dead. What does Dumbledore call these things when Harry gets back to Hogwarts? Anybody remember? Echoes. Try to go out in that hallway and yell echo really loud, what would you hear? Would you hear, get me a pepperoni pizza with extra cheese? No. Would you hear? When the connection is broken, we will linger for only moments. If these are echoes, they wouldn't be one aware. These are entirely aware. They are aware of what is going on at the present. They are aware of what went on in the past. How do we know? Because James says, get to the port key. Okay? Are these echoes? If they're not echoes, what are they?
Souls.
I think that's exactly what they are. Have they been trapped in Voldemort's wand all these years? Or minutes in Cedric's case? Nope. But it's the fact that the wands have connected that has drawn them to this place. We find out later, Dumbledore says, because of the priori incantatum spell, if the wands had stayed connected, what would have happened? Whoever he killed before he killed James would be the next one to pop out. And then the previous person. And then the previous person. And who finally? His parents. Because from everything we learn, his parents are his first kills. Okay. Do you understand, Harry? Yes. And then Cedric, you know, has to just take my body back. You know, and Harry doesn't say, kind of busy here, Cedric. We'll come back for it. I will. James, do it now. Be ready to run. Do it now. Okay. If these are souls, I think they are. I think when Rowling says Dumbledore say they're echoes, I think that's a head fake. She does a lot of head fakes in the books. Okay. If these are echoes, go back to the first book. Or if these are souls, go back to the first book. What does Harry see when he looks in the mirror? This is what he sees. Not this scene. He sees the souls of his parents. Why? What is his deepest desire? It's to be with his family. King's Cross, or Into the Forbidden Forest, Book 7. If you haven't read it yet, I won't give it away. Okay? I just gave a lot of it away, but I won't give it all away. So, now Harry yells. He didn't think he could have held on for another moment anyway. Pulls his wand upward with an almighty wrench. The gold thread breaks. He runs as he'd never run in his life. Notice we're not told how far he has to run. Knocking two stunned Death Eaters aside as he passed, zigzagging behind headstones, feeling their curses following him, hearing them hit the headstones. He's dodging curses and graves, pelting towards Cedric's body, no longer aware of the pain in his leg, his whole being concentrated on what he had to do. Voldemort, stun him! 10 feet from Cedric?
Which may be 24 feet from...
10 feet from Cedric, Harry dives behind a marble angel. Nice little touch there. Not moving angels. Back to the Doctor Who. to avoid the jets of red light and saw that. That would have been cool, by the way, if in the movie, if they had, for the angel, they had used one of the Doctor Who. One of the weeping angels. That would have been killer. Gripping his wand more tightly, he dashes out from behind the angel. Impedimenta, he yells. Okay. He gets to Cedric's body and oxio to the cup. Right? He's back at the school. Everybody sees Cedric's body. Moody comes, takes him. up to his dungeon, or to his office, I should say, and starts asking all kinds of questions. And I'm going to pick up with 675. Harry, on 674, there's a Death Eater at Hogwarts. There's a Death Eater at Hogwarts. I know who the Death Eater is. 675. He forgave them. The Death Eaters who went free, the ones who escaped Azkaban? Harry, what? I asked you whether he forgave the scum who never even went to look for him. I mean, when I fired the Dark Market, you fired? What are you talking about? I told you, Harry, I told you. If there's one thing I hate more than any other, it's a Death Eater who walked free. Harry, it can't be you. Who put your name in the Goblet of Fire under the name of a different school? I did. Who frightened off every person I thought might try to hurt you or prevent you from winning the tournament? I did. Who nudged Hagrid into showing you the dragons? I did. Who helped you see the only way you could beat the dragon? I did. Hasn't been easy, Harry, guiding you through these tasks. He says, I knew you hadn't worked out the egg's clue, so I had to give you another hint. Harry, you didn't. Cedric did. Who told Cedric to open it underwater? I did. Trusted that he would pass the information on to you. Notice the sentence. Decent people are so easy to manipulate, Potter. Cedric would want to repay you for telling about the dragons, and so he did. What does he mean, decent people are so easy to manipulate? Why are decent people so easy to manipulate?
Because they trust easily?
Yes. Okay, but it's more than that. Trust is involved. What else?
They believe in the inherent good of other people.
Remember Harry's reaction to Cedric? When Cedric says, why are you telling me? And Harry is full of disbelief. And he says, he couldn't believe anyone would think that if they had seen the dragons that they were going to have to go up against. Decent people think what of other people? That they are decent too. Okay? I was watching all the time. He says, you know, you were in the library all those hours. I gave Longbottom the damn book. You never asked for help. He says, so what can I do? Feed you information from another source. Okay? The Dark Lord didn't manage to kill you, Potter, page 678, and he so wanted to. So I'll do it. Page 679, after Harry says you're mad, there's a stupefy, blinding flash of red light. With a great splintering and crashing, the door of Moody's office was blasted apart. Harry sees Snape, McGonagall, and Dumbledore. And at that moment, he understood for the first time why people said Dumbledore was the only wizard Voldemort had ever feared. The look upon Dumbledore's face as he stared down at the unconscious form of Mad-Eye Moody was more terrible than Harry could ever have ever imagined. There's no benign smile upon Dumbledore's face, no twinkle in the eyes behind the spectacles. There's cold fury in every line of the ancient face. A sense of power radiated from Dumbledore, as though he were giving off burning heat. In other words, this is Dumbledore uncloaked. This is Albus, whose name means white. Okay? This is Dumbledore the White revealing himself. You don't mess with Dumbledore. Okay? So McGonagall says, come along, Harry. Dumbledore says no. He'll stay Minerva. He needs to understand. What does he need to understand? Understanding is the first step to acceptance, and only with acceptance can there be recovery. He needs to know who has put him through the ordeal he has suffered tonight and why. Harry, Moody? Dumbledore, this isn't Moody. So he tells Severus to go get the strongest truth serum, and Harry's like, I know where it is. Okay. So Snape comes back. They find the real Alastor Moody. Okay. They give the Veritaserum to Barty Crouch. and he spills the beans. Okay. Winky's there. Say no more, Master Bucky. Say no. Yeah, shut up, you stupid little. Gotta just kill it right there. skip a bunch. Talks about how he had attacked his father, how he used the Imperius curse on his father, the whole plan. Okay. Pick up with the parting of the ways. Dumbledore asks McGonagall to stand guard over Barty Crouch while he takes Harry upstairs. She says yes. He tells Snape to tell Madame Pomfrey to come downstairs to help Alistair Moody into the hospital wing, and then to go find Fudge, bring him up to this office. Okay. Takes Harry up to his office and says Sirius is waiting for us. Harry asks about the Diggories. Finds out they're with Professor Sprout, because Sprout was head of their school. Page 694, Dumbledore says, I need to know what happened after you touched the portkey in the maze, Harry. Sirius isn't really up for that. We can leave that till morning. Let him have a sleep. Let him rest. Look at Dumbledore's response. If I thought I could help you by putting you into an enchanted sleep and allowing you to postpone the moment when you would have to think about what has happened tonight, I would do it. But I know better. Numbing the pain for a while will make it worse when you finally feel it. Have any of you ever experienced anything like this? I don't mean psychologically, which is what Dumbledore's talking about.
Surgery, yes.
Yeah. Like surgery. Okay? Numbing the pain for a while will make it worse when you finally feel it. If you've ever had something physically happen to you that you've then been giving a numbing agent and then had to wait for the numbing agent to come off before you go in for the real surgery, hurts like hell. Okay? You have shown bravery beyond anything I could have expected of you. I ask you to demonstrate your courage one more time. I ask you to tell us what happened. So, Harry lets rip. He says, page 696, he said my blood would make him stronger than he'd if he'd used someone else's. He said the protection my mother left to me, he'd have it too. And he was right, he could touch me. For a fleeting instant, Harry thought he saw a gleam of something like triumph in Dumbledore's eyes. When this book came out and that line was read, the discussion lists and message boards just lit up because people thought, Dumbledore's in on it with Voldemort. But next second, Harry was sure he'd imagined it. This is Dumbledore lit up, though. Why? Because at this moment, Dumbledore knows how to defeat Voldemort. If some of his other suppositions are correct. So, Voldemort has overcome that particular barrier. Continue, Harry. Sirius breaks it. The wands connected? Priori incantatum, Dumbledore mentions. The reverse spell effect? Dumbledore, exactly. They both share tail feathers from the same phoenix. This phoenix, Harry, didn't know that before. Fox? Yes. Sirius. Notice, Sirius knows that priori incantata means the reverse spell effect, but he doesn't know what it means. So what happens when a wand meets its brother? They won't work properly. If, however, the owners of the wands force the wands to do battle, one of the wands will force the other to regurgitate spells it has performed. Dumbledore says, which means some form of Cedric must have reappeared? Sirius. Okay, Sirius interprets Dumbledore's words. Diggory came back to life. No spell can reawaken the dead. All that would have happened is a kind of reverse echo. A shadow of the living Cedric would have emerged from the wand. Really? Do shadows speak in the present tense and describe what is going on now as well as what happened in the past? He spoke to me. The ghost Cedric, or whatever he was, spoke in echo, which retained Cedric's appearance and character. How long ago did Harry's parents die? Okay, Harry's 14. They died just after his first birthday. 13 years ago. And they still retain the appearance and character? Come on. An old man, Bertha Jorkins, and your parents? Yes. More would have appeared. Very well, Harry. These echoes, these shadows, what did they do? And Harry says, okay. Dumbledore, I'll say it again. You've shown bravery beyond anything I could have expected of you tonight, Harry. Bravery equal to those who died fighting Voldemort at the height of his powers. You shouldered a grown wizard's burden and found yourself equal to it. And you've now given us all we have a right to expect. We must expect great things from you, Mr. Potter, Ollivander told him. Okay? So Dumbledore just said, we don't get to expect anything else from you. So, I'm going to give you some sleeping potion. Mrs. Weasley comes in. Okay. There's like a shouting match going on. Fudge comes in. And page 702. Dumbledore says, when Dumbledore comes sweeping into the hospital ward, what's happened? Why are you disturbing these people? Minerva, I'm surprised at you. I asked you to stand over Barty Crouch. She says there's no need. Why? What has Barty Crouch done that Dumbledore expressly forbid in book three? He allowed Dementors into the castle. And he allowed the Dementors to give Barty Crouch Jr. the Dementor's kiss. And Fudge says, he's no loss. He's been responsible for several deaths, Dumbledore, but now he can't give testimony. Or you could put it another way. He droned him. But now he can't give testimony. He can't give evidence about why he killed those people. Why? He was mad. He was crazy. He said Voldemort was giving him instructions. Lord Voldemort was giving him instructions. Fudge looks as though someone had just swung a heavy weight into his face. He stares back at Dumbledore. You know who? Returned? Preposterous. Come now, Dumbledore. So Dumbledore says, as Minerva and Severus have doubtless told you, we heard Barty Crouch confess. In other words, three eyewitnesses. What could they do if they wanted to? They could put Dumbledore, Snape, and McGonagall under Veritaserum and question them. And they tell the truth. See here, Dumbledore, you can't seriously believe that. You know who? Come back. Come now, certainly. Okay? Dumbledore says, I believe Harry. Why doesn't Crouch believe Harry? Where's Crouch get his information from? The Daily Prophet. What did Rita Skeeter say about Harry? Her last big scoop. He's crazy. You're prepared to believe that Lord Voldemort has returned on the word of a lunatic murderer and a boy who, well, Harry, you've been reading Rita Skeeter. Right? And Dumbledore starts to emanate that anger and the blue fire and the sparkly stuff. And says to Fudge, 706, Harry is as sane as you or I. That scar upon his forehead is not Adam's brains. Harry, I saw Voldemort come back. I saw the Death Eaters. I can give you their names. Lucius Malfoy was cleared, says Fudge. Very old family. Donations to excellent causes. McNair, also cleared. Now working for the ministry. Gadget should tell you something. Avery, Knott, Crabbe, Goyle. You're repeating the names of those who were acquitted of being Death Eaters 13 years ago. Could have found it in old reports. McGonagall, Cedric Diggory. Explain that. Right? Fudge, a Dumbledore. Voldemort has returned, page 707. If you accept that fact straight away, Fudge, and take the necessary measures, we may still be able to save the situation. So what's his first piece of advice? Get the Dementors away from Azkaban. I'd be kicked out of office. Half of us only feel safe in our beds at night because we know the Dementors are standing guard at Azkaban. And Dumbledore says, and the rest of us sleep less well at night, knowing that Dementors are there. Okay? Dumbledore, 708. Fudge. When Dumbledore says, and here are some other things you can do. Send envoys to the giants. Fudge says it would be the end of my career. Notice what's important to him. The wizarding world or his career? You are blinded by the level of office you hold, Cornelius. You place too much importance, and you always have done, on the so-called purity of blood. You fail to recognize it matters not what someone is born, but what they grow to be. You could almost take that as your money quote. It matters not what someone is born, but what they grow to be. In other words, what they make of the life that's been given them. What kind of life has Hagrid been given? Pretty raw deck. I mean, a pretty raw deal. But what's he done with it? He's turned it around. He's made it pretty good. What about Lupin? Now, he got a real raw deal. Okay? Your Dementor has just destroyed the last remaining member of a pure blood family, as old as any, and see what that man chose to make of his life. Barty Crouch Jr. was dealt what kind of hand at birth? Royal flush, man. He had it made. And what did he do with it? He threw it all away. I tell you now, take the steps I've suggested, you'll be remembered in office or out as one of the bravest and greatest ministers of magic we've ever known. Fail to act, and history will remember you as the man who stepped aside and allowed Voldemort a second chance. Okay? How does Fudge take Dumbledore's kind of ultimatum? Well, you know, I've always given you free rein, old man. If you're going to work against me, against the ministry, Dumbledore, the only one against whom I intend to work is Lord Voldemort. If you are against him, then we remain on the same side. If you're against Voldemort, we're on the same side. He can't be back, Dumbledore. He just can't be. That's Fudge letting the defenses down. Why can't he be? Why can't Fudge accept the truth? What would it mean for the beautiful little world he has created in his mind, if nowhere else? I mean, think about this for a minute. What would happen? Here's a supposal. Suppose it's October 26th, 2012. What is about to happen in about a week? 2012, 4 years ago. Almost 4 years ago. Presidential election. Okay? We've got one coming up in a year. We've got people running for office. Okay? Suppose for a moment. Now, what were one of the things Obama ran for re-election on? Biden actually said this at the Democratic National Convention. Bin Laden is dead and GM is alive. Kill Bin Laden, save the auto industry. What would have happened if on October 26th, it was discovered, not only it was discovered, but Bin Laden released a videotape showing him, New York Times, October 26th, 2012, 1 week before the election. What would have done for Obama's re-election chances? There wouldn't have been any. It would have been gone. Okay? This is why, okay, Fudge can't allow. Is he up for re-election? No. But what does it mean? How long has Voldemort been gone? 13 years. In other words, they've had 13 years of peace. 13 years of people kind of getting in the groove of their life and just going on fat, dumb, and happy. And then all of a sudden, the big bad, and Bin Laden is nothing. Nothing compared to Voldemort. I mean, to get the real parallel, you'd have to go back more like to 1958. And Hitler reappears. Okay? Imagine what that would mean. Talk about blowing your mind. Okay? That's what it would mean. Everybody would now have all kinds of thoughts about Ike. Of course, they couldn't do anything about it because he'd already been reelected in 56. Okay? He can't be back, Dumbledore. He just can't be. And one person who can offer proof is Snape. And what do? He walks up to him and he pulls his sleeve up. And he shows him the dark mark. There, the dark mark. Not as clear as it was an hour or so ago when it burned black, but you can still see it. Every Death Eater had the sign burned into him. Okay, now keep in mind, who's in the room when Snape is doing this? Harry? McGonagall? Did they know before? Harry knew from the pensive. Did McGonagall know? It was a means of distinguishing one another, his means of summoning us to them. When he touched the mark of any Death Eater, we were to apparate instantly at his side. This mark has been growing clear all year. Karkaroff's too. Why do you think Karkaroff fled tonight? We both felt the mark burn. We both knew he'd return. Karkaroff fears the Dark Lord's vengeance. Fudge steps back. He goes over to Harry. Drops the money on the bedside table. Here's your winnings. Oh, who else is there? Molly Weasley. Snape reveals himself to Molly Weasley? Okay. So, Dumbledore starts to get the old crowd together. He asks Molly if he can trust on she and Arthur. He says, she says, yes, of course. He says, I need a message sent to Arthur. Okay. Bill goes. He asks the Minerva to get Hagrid and Madame Maxime. Okay? And then he has somebody reveal himself. And Sirius turns from the big black dog into himself. Molly goes batshit crazy. You know. Ron's, shut up, Mom. Okay. Page 713. Severus. You know what I ask you to do. If you're ready, if you're prepared, I am. What does Snape have to do? Well, he just told Fudge. If Voldemort touches the Dark Mark, you're supposed to disapparate and apparate wherever he is. He's got to go back to Voldemort after spending 13 years as Dumbledore's lapdog, as other people call him. Okay? And we get the beginning. The beginning of what? War. Okay? We find out about Rita Skeeter. Hermione traps her. Literally traps her. Has her in a jar. Okay? Because she's an animagus. And Dumbledore gives the end of the year feast speech. Page 723. 722 and 23. He says, Cedric was a person who exemplified many of the qualities that distinguish Hufflepuff House. He was a good, loyal friend, hard worker, valued fair play. His death has affected you all. I want you to know how he died. He was murdered by Lord Voldemort. Everybody hisses and oohs and ahs. The Ministry of Magic does not wish me to tell you this, which means it should have what effect on the students? You've just been told the government doesn't want you to know this. Hell yes! You want to know. It's possible some of your parents will be horrified that I've done so, either because they will not believe Lord Voldemort has returned, or because they think I should not tell you so, young as you are. Now keep in mind, how old are some of his charges? It's kind of young to be told that Hitler's back, or Satan's back. Actually, closer to Satan. There's somebody else who must be mentioned in connection with Cedric's death. Harry Potter. Harry's like, thanks, you know. You know, all attention on him now. He risked his own life to return Cedric's body to Hogwarts. He showed in every respect the sort of bravery few wizards have ever shown in facing Lord Voldemort. For this I honor him. And Dumbledore raises a glass to Harry. And then he says, every guest in this hall, and his eyes lingers upon the Durmstrang students, will be welcome back here at any time should they wish to come. I say to you all once again, in the light of Lord Voldemort's return, we are only as strong as we are united, as weak as we are divided. He's not talking only about British wizards and witches. Lord Voldemort's gift for spreading discord and enmity is very great. We can fight it only by showing an equally strong bond of friendship and trust. It's my belief, and never have I hoped so, that I'm mistaken, that we're all facing dark and difficult times. Some of you in this hall have already suffered directly at the hands of Lord Voldemort. Many of your families have been torn asunder. We don't know exactly who those are yet. We know some of them. Harry. Neville. Who else? Well, we find out in the next two books. Other families. Remember Cedric. Remember, if the time should come when you have to make a choice between what is right and what is easy, remember what happened to a boy who was good and kind and brave because he strayed across the path of Lord Voldemort. But what does that have to do with Cedric? He strayed across the path of Voldemort. What does that have to do with making a choice between what is right and what is easy? How did Cedric stray across Voldemort's path?
Because he didn't take the cup on himself.
He's right.
He didn't take the cup. It was right behind him. Harry said, take it. Cedric said, no. Why? Because it wouldn't be right. Either way, if Cedric took the cup or if he took the cup with Harry, what was going to happen to Cedric?
He
was a dead man walking, man. Okay? The only way Cedric wouldn't have died is what? If Harry had gone entirely against his character.
If Harry had gone, you're a damn Hufflepuff. Nobody likes you. This is Gryffindor's glory, you know. Which wouldn't have fit his character. Cedric does what is right. Harry did what was right. Notice, neither of them did the easy thing. They did the hard thing. And it ended up with one of them dead. Okay? All right, we'll stop there since we only have 9 minutes here. Unless you have any questions. Didn't think so.